Welcome to the Friday morning Pediatric COVID Update series. We've really enjoyed this series hearing from Norton Children's Hospital's physicians and leaders, and are excited to hear from the mental health team today about further updates. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Drs. Felissa Goldstein, Christy Schultz, and Dr. Courtney Smith.
Thank you all so much for having us. I am Christy Vil Schultz, and I will get us started today. So out of the three presenters today, myself, Dr. Goldstein, and Dr. Smith, none of us have conflicts of interest to disclose. Our learning objectives today will first be to detail the importance of mental health during the COVID-19 pandemic. And then we'll discuss the impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic on mental health for children and adolescents, as well as discuss applicable coping skills. We'll also discuss impacts of the pandemic on families, as well as on healthcare providers today. So why is this so important? Why is this topic a needed discussion today? So I wanted to start with the United Nations policy brief, which came out a little bit earlier this month about COVID-19 and the need for action on mental health. And it states directly that although the COVID-19 crisis is, in the first instance, a physical health crisis, it has the seeds of a major mental health crisis as well. Good mental health is critical to the functioning of society at the best of times. It must be front and center of every country's response to and recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. The mental health and well-being of whole societies have been severely impacted by this crisis and are a priority to be addressed urgently. It's important to note further that psychological distress in populations is widespread, and that many people are distressed due to the immediate health impacts of the virus and the consequences of physical isolation. Many are afraid of infection, dying, and losing family members. Individuals have been physically distanced from loved ones and peers. Millions of people are facing economic turmoil, having lost or being at risk of losing their income and livelihoods. Frequent misinformation and rumors about the virus and deep uncertainty about the future are common sources of distress. A long-term upsurge in the number and severity of mental health problems is likely. So when we talk about the impact of the pandemic on mental health, we think about the impacts even of quarantine. So these things impact everyone. And so while life-threatening physical health impacts are going to personally impact a few, the mental health consequences will impact everyone. It's important to note that stress not only precipitates new episodes of mental illness, but a relapse or exacerbation of known mental illness as well. The impacts on mental health may include a number of different things. Like I said, this will lead to increased stress. This can lead to increased fear. So if we think about those who have been fearful, and which has led to buying and stocking goods, this can lead to the impacts can lead to low self-esteem, disappointment, irritability, helplessness, loneliness, insomnia, social isolation. And social isolation is a really important one because this is a precursor to many mental health conditions. And so we also look at increased anxiety and depression, PTSD, panic disorder, substance use, domestic violence, child abuse, self-harm, and also suicidality. The impact on mental health can occur immediately, but this is going to last over long periods of time. And if left untreated, these psychological symptoms may have long-term health effects on patients and require treatments, adding to the cost burden of managing the illness. So I'll highlight data, and there are a number of different ways right now that the impacts are being measured, but I'll highlight just a few of those studies. So when we look at the data from the United Nations, they indicate that national surveys are revealing higher prevalence of distress in population during COVID-19. So we see that the United States is showing about 45%. There are also researchers out of San Diego State University and Florida State University, and this is currently unpublished data, but it's the data that they're finding is indicating that adults in the U.S. are 8 times more likely to experience serious mental distress than in 2018. And so they're showing that serious mental distress right now in the U.S. Is about 27%. But if we include moderate or severe mental distress, they're finding that about 70% of the population is indicating that level of distress. And so it's a concern not only for the pandemic, but also the associated recession, which historically has had a negative impact on mental health. The CDC has released some data. This data was, they began collecting the data at the end of April of 2020, and they are looking at symptoms of anxiety and in depression, and the goal is to continue data collection for 90 days. So as you see here on the slide, Kentucky is a dark shade of green. So we're showing, as a population, higher symptoms of anxiety and depression. And when we look specifically about where our state ranks, if we look at previous weeks of data, Kentucky was ranked number 16, then number 11, and right now we're number 8 in regards to where we rank with our population reporting symptoms of anxiety and depression. This is a very real problem for our residents of our state. When we discuss the role of mental health providers during the pandemic, there's a number of things to highlight here. So we have a role to educate the public about common psychological effects of a pandemic, to encourage health-promoting behaviors, to integrate mental health and physical health care services as much as possible, because truly integrated care is going to best provide the comprehensive care that patients and residents are going to need. Teaching problem-solving strategies, empowering patients with COVID-19 and their caregivers, providing that support to them and their families, as well as providing care and encouraging self-care for healthcare providers. Important to note that people will respond differently to the pandemic. And when we talk about distress, this could take a number of different forms. This could be a mild distress, which maybe just need reassurance or strength and social support. But this could also take the form of moderate to severe distress, which would require consulting mental health professionals. Treatment can include a number of things. It could include psychological interventions or pharmacological interventions, or ideally a combination of the two. And so it's important as well to note that most individuals don't have checkups for their mental health, but they may have checkups for their health. And so it's vital for healthcare providers to be attentive to the mental health needs of patients and to know the resources to be able to aid them during this pandemic as well. And so we'll discuss how the pandemic is impacting three different areas. And so I'm going to continue today by talking about how this is impacting children and adolescents specifically. So when we talk about the impacts on overall functioning of youth, we think about really kind of when do children thrive? So in the best of times, when are children doing well? And children tend to thrive when they're safe and when they're protected, when their family and community connections are safe and they're stable and when their basic needs are met. So thinking about Maslow's hierarchy here, we need to make sure that the basic needs of children are being met. And we think about what children's lives look like during a pandemic and their lives are disrupted. The pandemic is impacting nearly every aspect of a child's life. It impacts their health, their development, their learning environment, their family setting, their economic security, protection from violence and abuse, as well as their mental health. So just thinking about the children and the adolescents that you know and that you've worked with, think about, you know, the teens who are no longer able to go to prom or they were about to graduate from high school and they're unable to celebrate those milestones and the impact that that may have on them. Thinking about the children who spend their summers at summer camp and now don't have that option. So thinking about the overall impact that that has on youth. Younger children as well are at great risk right now. High levels of stress and isolation can impact their brain development, sometimes with long-term consequences. And as well, all of these changes are coming at a very critical point for emotional development in children and adolescents. So when we discuss difficulties in functioning for youth, this data is from the United Nations policy brief, but it's looking at data that's coming out of Italy and Spain. And so they're finding that the symptoms that they're noticing in children, first and foremost, is difficulty concentrating, and that was 77% of children, followed by irritability, restlessness, nervousness, and feelings of loneliness. Data coming out of China looking at children ages 3 to 18 found a number of other areas of impaired functioning. So they found that individuals and children, they were more clingy. They also were more attentive, but they were irritable. They were worried. They were obsessively requesting updates, and they were fearful for the health of their relatives. But also that this impacted their sleeping, their appetite, their energy levels, and also caused nightmares and just overall discomfort for children. All of these things can mean a number of things in regards to psychological diagnoses. It's important to note that some children, though, may cope in a healthy manner, but others may experience more worries, more anxiety. They might be worried about being isolated from their family and friends, and catching or even dying from COVID-19. We can see this in adjustment disorders, acute stress disorder, or PTSD. We can see this with increased depression. And as well, when we talk about depression, it's important to note suicide rates. And so suicide is currently the second leading cause of death in those aged 15 to 29. And with further stressors and concern for increased suicidality, this is immensely important to consider as well. Most mental health disorders do begin in childhood. So it's imperative that mental health needs are identified early and treated. If untreated, mental health needs can lead to negative health and social outcomes. Also, while many people may have previously coped well, they may have impaired coping right now due to multiple stressors caused by the pandemic. And as we know, children who encounter adverse childhood experiences are at higher risk for health conditions. So thinking about how this is impacting the number of adverse events that they are going to experience. When looking specifically at the impacts of school closures and social isolation on children, we see difficulties accessing social supports or seeing their peers. So there's no one really to check to make sure that they're okay as there once was. A number of children do receive their mental health services at school. So among all adolescents who use mental health services, about 57% receive some school-based mental health services. 35% received mental health services exclusively from school settings. It's important to note that adolescents and racial and ethnic minorities with lower family income or with public health insurance are disproportionately likely to receive mental health services exclusively from school settings, and so are at a disadvantage right now with not being able to receive those services. There's difficulty adjusting back to kind of quote normal life after the pandemic, especially for children with diagnoses such as depression. Children with special education needs are at risk as well. So children with autism may become frustrated when their schedule is disrupted, or children with learning disorders may not be getting the services that they need. College students have both an academic and financial burden associated with the pandemic. And it's important to note how this may be a challenge for our LGBTQ youth, especially those who are home from college right now or feel as though they cannot be safe going home from college and have to find alternative living environments. And so this causes additional stress for our LGBTQ youth. Some children may be isolating in an abusive home. And so social isolation and school closures limiting the number of mandated reporters who are seeing children. It's important to note as well that we will need additional research to look at the additional impacts of the pandemic on the well-being of children and adolescents. So what are some ways to support children and adolescents? What can we do to help? What can we recommend? The first thing is to create and enforce a schedule. It's important that children stick to schedules, so we want to control the things that we can during an uncertain time. They need regular sleep and wake times, regular meal times. They need scheduled social time, time for activities or crafts, or time for exercise. It's important to explain the pandemic in an age-appropriate manner. We want to be honest, but we want to be honest in a way that is developmentally appropriate for the children or adolescents. It's important to foster resilience and provide support. Dr. Goldstein will be detailing this a little bit more in just a moment. Adults and families do need to model positive psychological attitudes. Children look to their families and adults as to how to cope with things. And so if adults are calm, children will be able to be more calm as well. It's important to divert attention to more productive and positive directions. And so this may include things like limiting media coverage for children and having them put their attention into things that they enjoy and that are more productive for them. It's important to ask how children and adolescents are feeling, to validate their feelings and to be available to talk. And then also it's important to help children and adolescents seek mental health support if needed. In regards to resources for children and adolescents, there are a number of resources in circulation right now with different books to help children understand the pandemic. But the ones I really want to highlight today are resources targeting safety. So as we know, teenagers are more likely to text than to talk. And so there is a crisis text hotline, so they can text HOME to 741-741. There's a national suicide prevention hotline as well. And then for our LGBTQ youth, the Trevor Project has resources which include texting resources, talking resources, or resources available in a chat feature online. And so it's critical right now to be aware of safety information so that we're helping to disseminate the information to children, adolescents, and their families to make sure that they have the resources that they need to be safe. So thank you so much for your time. And now I'm going to turn things over to Dr. Goldstein.
Thank you, Dr. Schultz. My name is Dr. Felissa Goldstein, and I'm going to talk about the psychological impact on families. So what can happen during this pandemic? There can be an increase in alcohol abuse. There can be an increased risk for domestic violence, as potentially coming from more people being unemployed, more financial stress, limited resources and social supports, higher levels of alcohol abuse. Also, during the pandemic, there are increased gun sales. Additionally, something that I personally hadn't thought of, but that the releasing of prisoners early may pose risks for victims. What are some of the tools that abusers will use during domestic violence or child abuse? They will isolate the victim from friends, family, and employment. They will maintain constant surveillance over the victim, asking them anytime they go anyplace else, anytime they do anything else. Anytime they go outside of the house, they may hold on to their money so that they can't buy anything. They may have a long list of rules that they need to follow for their behavior. Also, they may have limited access to basic necessities, food, clothing, sanitary facilities, or supplies. Domestic violence and child abuse increase when families spend more time together. Children in homes with domestic violence have a 60 times greater risk of abuse or neglect. Lockdowns, when the families are all together in the house 24/7, really increase the level of family distress. Additionally, because the pandemic was somewhat unexpected, there aren't a lot of public health measures that were put in place at the beginning so that we could protect victims or treat victims. Additionally, with problems within the economy, a lot of support programs are actually being cut. Places like houses of worship, school, or work, which used to be a reprieve for a victim from a perpetrator, are gone. So now they're home with the perpetrator 24/7. The pattern has evolved throughout the world that a lot occurs in an area, and then about 10 days later, the number of distress calls spikes. Agencies that normally protect victims are struggling to help them because of the increasing numbers of people requiring assistance. The need for isolation due to the pandemic disrupts people's natural support networks, family members that they went to, or other people are not available or unreachable. What do previous natural events show us about the impact of these events on families' mental health? Domestic violence reports increased 46% in Othello, Washington after Mount St. Helens erupted. Female victims of psychological abuse by their partner increased 35% after Hurricane Katrina. Physical abuse by a partner doubled in southernmost Mississippi counties after Hurricane Katrina. COVID-19 around the world. During China's stay-at-home mandate, domestic violence rates tripled. In China, Equality, which is an organization that's used to combat violence against women, saw a surge in calls after the lockdown started. In Spain, an emergency number for domestic violence victims had an 18% increase in calls during the first 2 weeks of the lockdown. France reports a 30% increase in domestic violence, and the rates are increasing in Italy, United States, and Spain. Additionally, there's concern that a lot of these numbers may be low because a victim may currently be unable to report their current situation because of them being locked up in their house. Child abuse and neglect. Interestingly, agencies have reported a significant drop in the number of child abuse and neglect reports. But the reality is there's actually no decrease in the abuse, but there is less ability to detect the cases. In the United States, 67% of substantiated child abuse reports come from victim-serving professionals and 19% from school personnel, with a lot of those agencies being closed, the child abuse reports are not coming in. There's also, looking ahead, there's also significant concern that when schools return, there'll be increasing numbers of reports, but agencies are already overwhelmed, and so with increasing numbers of reports, it's going to be very difficult for the children to receive the support and care that they need. So this is a graphic that I found that I think is very helpful to look at building resilience really for anybody, but I took it from a sort of a family approach. So on one side, you'll see there's all the negative stressors, or they call them negative outcomes. Things like job loss, physically distanced, closing school, family members, or somebody with COVID-19. Then there's the fulcrum that helps keep everything in balance. And then on the positive side, there's things that contribute to a positive outcome. Things like relationships, unemployment benefits, stable housing, stable food sources. So let's look at how do we support families to help everybody maintain their physical and mental health. So as a provider, we can help families maintain their basic needs. For example, our general pediatrics downtown clinic has a food pantry. We also can look to help connect families to needed resources. So by lightening the load on the negative outcome side, we're tipping the scale towards a balance of positive outcomes. We can also assist unemployed adults in financial assistance, sending them to organizations that maybe can pay a bill for a month, or encouraging them to apply for unemployment. Additionally, even something so simple like creating care packages or fun packages, activity kits for kids, things that might keep them busy for a half hour or so, may give a caregiver a much needed break. Encouraging parents to practice self-care is also a huge way of decreasing family stress. Often very difficult for families, but even if it's, you know, a half hour after a child goes to bed, it still can be a beneficial opportunity for the parent to practice some self-care. How do we increase the positive outcomes, furthering the scale to go down towards the positive outcome side and alleviating the negative outcomes? It's important to encourage responsive relationships in adults and children. And this really applies for everybody. It's reaching out to your friends, both as adults and children, also within your own family, responding to your child's needs, responding to your spouse's needs. Also, it's been found that resilience actually increases with stable, supportive relationships. So while sometimes when people are depressed or anxious, you want to hide and avoid those relationships, those are an important piece to help people stay strong. It's helpful. Data has shown that it's even helpful when providers check in with families, not necessarily because there's something wrong, but just to help check in with them, it reduces their feeling of isolation. Maintaining and encouraging connections with family and friends, Zoom, FaceTime, Skype, all those things are super ways to maintain those connections of people that you can't physically see. They describe them as back and forth serve and return interactions. These are things that we can do that don't cost any money, and you can do them throughout the day. So what can we do to move the fulcrum towards the positive outcome side? So one of the things you want to do is strengthen core life skills. So helping people, give them ideas for less frequent trips to the store. Help them or assist them or direct them to assistance for finding relief funds or loans, navigating support programs, managing work, home, and caring for children, using assistive devices, things like sending or signing up for text reminders of appointments, using tools like grocery list apps, menu planners, and daily schedules that enable the whole family to see a schedule, referencing back to Dr. Schultz's suggestion that children benefit most when they have a daily schedule. Also, for things that you find that you're having to help families with over and over again, creating a step-by-step checklist for accessing relief funds and filling out important applications. So one other key piece that I thought was important when I was looking at working to help families was to support our families, the families of essential workers, reassuring the family members that any of their distress and worry are normal. It's okay. It's normal for them to be scared of what mom or dad may be doing when they go into the hospital every day. Everybody needs time for rest and recharging. We have to exercise and focus on what we have control over. Things like exercise, sleep, avoiding alcohol and tobacco, ensuring that your family members are reading accurate information. And this is an important one that I think everybody has to remember, is that during these difficult times, don't worry about having to do everything perfectly. Also, having a set of family rules, hygiene rules, hand washing, cleaning common areas. What kind of special precautions need to be taken? Do your kids need to understand and learn that when you come home from work, that they can't touch you until after you've taken a shower? Using games, songs, and distractions to help kids cope. Also, looking at your family's needs to determine if, as an essential worker, if that essential worker must live away or quarantine in the house. Also, always helping families understand the nature of what the worker does is super important. Even phrasing it as the worker is on a critical mission and encouraging a family to feel pride about what their worker is doing. If a worker has to be away from the house, maintaining communication, again, FaceTime, Zoom, Skype, those are all our friends. Also, importantly, remembering that the separation is only temporary. We want to work together as a family to overcome any of the challenges, and it's okay to accept assistance from others. Thank you very much. I'm going to turn this over to Dr. Smith.
Good morning. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you all this morning about the impact of COVID on medical providers. So in other words, I guess we could call this the preaching to the choir portion of the presentation. As I transition from Dr. Goldstein speaking about the adjustment of parents and families, and as we've reflected this morning on the psychological toll of the pandemic on youth as presented by Dr. Schultz, it's important to note that all of what we've already touched on affects each of us as we navigate this time as healthcare workers, not only as we guide our patients and their families in our professional lives, but also as we support and cope alongside our own parents, children, spouses, extended families, friends, and neighbors. So all that's already been discussed directly affects each of us on both personal and professional levels. For those who work in healthcare, there are multiple levels of impact. But just as in the case of many important topics that we discuss in Grand Rounds, I won't pretend that the 15 or so minutes I have to cover this topic will do it justice. We've all followed the news covering a range of stories on how COVID has impacted our fellow healthcare workers in other parts of the country and world, including those about the possible link between the care of COVID patients to the suicides of two New York City healthcare workers, a dedicated EMT and a top emergency medicine physician. Even so, in narrowing our focus and reviewing the literature out there specific to the impact on healthcare workers, I want to briefly share what I found regarding the social and occupational factors associated with the psychological impact of the pandemic, followed by some of the unfolding research on the primary manifestations of this psychological impact on healthcare workers, some of the protective factors, proposed models for healthcare worker resilience, and some practical and immediate wellness tools that are recommended. Brooks and her colleagues did a review of literature back in 2018, primarily looking at social and occupational factors associated with psychological well-being of healthcare workers during the SARS crisis. Some of what's noted here on the slide is fairly self-explanatory, but I wanted to highlight a few of their findings. In terms of occupational role, across studies, nurses were most likely to show symptoms of post-traumatic stress and report more symptoms of common mental health disorders in response to a healthcare crisis than those in other roles. Specifically, when compared to doctors, healthcare assistants, technicians, allied health professionals, transport workers, and administrative staff. In terms of specialized training and preparedness, perhaps a finding is that those more confident in their infection control knowledge and skills reported lower stress levels. Those in high-risk environments reported higher post-traumatic stress symptoms, greater overall stress and avoidance, and higher alcohol consumption. In one study, being quarantined as a healthcare worker was most strongly associated with acute stress disorder, with greater post-traumatic stress symptoms, with feeling stigmatized, with reluctance to return to work, and even a consideration of resignation, and with higher alcohol intake. In considering overall social factors, it probably comes as no surprise that greater organizational, peer, and family support was found to be associated with lower risk of mental health problems overall. Shifting our attention to how the psychological impact of a healthcare crisis or pandemic manifests in healthcare workers, we see here results from one study on SARS and two, both from China, on COVID. The SARS study only measured post-traumatic stress symptoms, with 10% of healthcare workers endorsing these symptoms. The rest of the findings here are from the two COVID studies. So up to nearly half of healthcare workers who responded reported increased symptoms of anxiety and depression, about a third reported insomnia, and nearly three quarters reported overall distress. The SARS study only surveyed doctors, nurses, and administrative healthcare workers. One COVID study surveyed only doctors and nurses, and one COVID study surveyed everyone from doctors to maintenance staff. In keeping with what I already mentioned about knowledge and training in healthcare risks, one of the COVID studies found that among the 470 participants, anxiety was higher in non-medical healthcare workers than medical healthcare workers. In the other COVID study, of the 1,830 participants, more severe degrees of all measurements of mental health were reported by nurses and frontline healthcare workers. As this study had participants from 34 hospitals across China, it's interesting to note that those in Wuhan had the highest ratings across all measures. Of course, there are limitations for these studies in terms of generalization to other countries, and all noted that pre-existing symptom levels were unknown, though among the 470 participants in one of the COVID studies, not one participant reported pre-existing mental health symptoms. Though not measured, other issues that were mentioned in studies included concerns for increased substance use, suicide risk, burnout, and compassion fatigue. In a manuscript written in response to COVID earlier this month, Albert and her colleagues created this figure to illustrate the confluence of physiologic, cognitive, emotional, and interpersonal responses that a given healthcare worker can have to the pandemic that can determine resilience versus burnout. I know it may be a little hard to read. There's a lot of detail and it's small. The risks or concerns are in red, and what we might call protective factors or even coping skills are in green. We can see, for example, that whether a healthcare worker responds primarily with hopelessness versus optimism, with cynicism versus self-compassion, or whether or not they're able to maintain sleep and exercise routines can determine resiliency versus burnout. And these risk factors become cumulative. They don't typically just recede on their own. They'll eventually lead to burnout if not addressed. Similar to some of the factors listed in green on the previous slide, researchers in the studies I referenced earlier also discussed some additional data that impacted the experiences of healthcare workers, including that altruistic acceptance of work-related risks, preparedness, and volunteerism, as in those who volunteered to be on the front lines versus those who were mandated or perhaps even reassigned to be on the front lines, fared better from a mental health standpoint. They also noted positive outcomes reported by healthcare workers on the other side of a significant disease outbreak, including feelings of personal growth, a sense of achievement, greater appreciation for life, and positive feelings regarding peer support and teamwork. I also want to touch on a few evidence-based models that have been developed in hopes of maximizing the resilience of healthcare workers in times of medical crisis. The first model shown here, called the Anticipate, Plan, Deter, or APD model, was developed by Schreiber in 2018 and was implemented with positive outcomes noted in a paper in the Journal of Military Medicine describing portions of APD being used with first responders and with healthcare workers responding to a typhoon in the Philippines and to the Ebola epidemic in West Africa. Its aim is to replace the one-size-fits-all debriefing type models by offering what the developers refer to as hazard-specific stress inoculation during the pre-incident period. It involves the following steps. First, healthcare workers are educated about expected stress reactions and responses that may come about from a healthcare crisis. Second, each healthcare worker is taught to develop their own personal resilience plan to address the challenges that they personally anticipate, along with individualized ways to cope with these challenges. And finally, having undergone pre-incident training on how to be aware of personal stress responses, healthcare workers are trained to monitor their own stress exposure responses and understand what triggers would indicate the need to implement their coping plan. So this would all be done proactively as a part of routine training and then could be immediately employed in the event of a serious disease outbreak, pandemic, natural disaster, terrorist attack, etc. A second proposed evidence-based model has come about as a result of COVID-19, borrowing in part from military training and the APD model. Researchers from University of Minnesota developed the Psychological Resilience Intervention, or PRI. Taking what had been learned from previous medical outbreaks and societal crises, the goals of PRI were as follows. First, to support healthcare workers in maintaining their sense of psychological well-being, self-efficacy, and hope. Second, to connect each individual healthcare worker to their peers, to their unit or department, and to a mental health consultant. And third, to identify and support at-risk healthcare workers who may be predisposed to stress reactions because of lower initial resilience, inadequate appropriate coping, or exposure to atypically high risk levels, danger, or trauma during crisis. In this model, individual healthcare workers were assigned a battle buddy with a similar work assignment for informal daily conversations about challenges and successes. One of the benefits of a battle buddy is that useful insights and recommendations can be shared and can allow work issues to remain at work. Though time doesn't allow for me to delve in much deeper to this model or the next few levels, in a nutshell, increased supports can be provided as needed, including and up to accessing personal mental health services as needed, which is certainly something that any of us can take advantage of through our own EAP or the resource community. The manuscript also includes helpful ideas about how to implement the model within hospital systems and how to measure outcomes. While both the APD and PRI models provide great food for thought for planning for future crises that healthcare workers may encounter, I wanted to wrap up today and leave you with some more immediate resources and ideas for coping with circumstances that we currently find ourselves in. I would imagine that everyone listening today experienced an influx of emails and other correspondence related to COVID-19 that are specific to each of your specialty areas. And this has also been the case for those of us in behavioral and mental health. In combing through all of these, one that stood out for me, a host of wellness guides put together by the Department of Psychiatry at Emory University. Given our limited time, if you're interested in learning more, I would encourage you to simply Google Emory University Wellness Guides, where you'll see a link to one that is specific for healthcare workers. What I've listed here on the slide are the topics embedded in the guide, which encompass engaging in self-care, promoting teamwork, connecting with others, managing high-risk situations, and acknowledging grief responses and existential challenges. I just want to zero in a little more about self-care and say that what I particularly like about this wellness guide is that many of the self-care tools it recommends are very basic, such as making sure you're doing the best you can to eat healthily, to hydrate, to maintain a consistent sleep schedule as much as possible, but also that it focuses quite a bit on what I would consider to be cognitive behavioral tools that any of us can do in the moment. The notion of self-care can get a bad rap. We all agree that we would practice meditation, go to yoga, exercise more, .. We had time, but often we don't have time during our workday to engage in self-care offerings, and then we go home to busy family responsibilities. and perhaps we have even less time to do so during a pandemic. The things that take very little time, like checking in with yourself about how you're doing and feeling at the beginning, middle, and end of each shift, focusing on present tasks and challenges rather than past or future what-if scenarios, challenging negative thoughts that creep into our days, and differentiating between what is and isn't within our power and act accordingly, these are things we can do. Some of these are the very things that we in mental and behavioral health teach our patients to do each and every day. Further, and without it taking one bit of extra time, we can all try to be more accepting of our thoughts and feelings. We can all try to practice self-compassion and move about with an awareness that the stressful feelings we may be experiencing are understandable and valid. And each of these strategies can go farther than we might think toward enhancing our mental health. So I want to thank you very much for your attention today. Thank you for all three of us. We have a little time for questions, and Dr. Schultz-Goldstein and I would be happy to address any that you guys may have. And we would also certainly welcome any comments.
Thank you so much, Dr. Schultz-Goldstein. And Smith, that was a wonderful presentation discussing things that our patients, families, and even ourselves are going through. So if you want to take a moment to unmute your microphone, you can go ahead and ask questions. There's already been two questions from Dr. Schickler that I want to start off with. Is there any data from where there's been no restrictions in lifestyle, mobility, or socialization during the pandemic, knowing that home sheltering and decrease in exercise as well as UV light exposure can impact mood?
I am not familiar with any. We're all shaking our heads. Ken, do you have any? Dr. Schickler, do you know of any information? That would be really great. Does anyone in the audience have any information about that? It would be something we could certainly look into.
Okay, we'll move on with Dr. Schickler's second question. Dr. Schickler asked if you are muted. We cannot hear you earlier. If you want to try to talk again, please try. Do you want to try your microphone one more time, Dr. Schickler?
Am I on now? Hello? Can you hear me?
We can hear you a little bit.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
No, it's my fault. I couldn't find where to unmute my great technical skills. So certainly, we know that there's good evidence that exercise as well as sunlight do have an effect on mood, at least ultraviolet light for sure. But I was just wondering, it'd be very interesting to know if people in Sweden are monitoring anxiety, et cetera, in the population there where the kids and the adults aren't staying indoors and changing their lifestyle. Whereas, you know, certainly in large cities where people live in apartment buildings to start with and things like that in the United States, kids aren't really exercising, not getting outdoors and getting exposed to sunlight now that it's springtime. So it'd be just interesting data, in fact, based on what we know that exercise can do for mood as well as sunlight. That was the reason for that question.
Absolutely. I think those are really great points. I don't know the data, but it would be interesting if there is any to try to explore it or it would be interesting, an interesting study.
Give us just 1 second here. We are going to stop sharing that portion so we can hear you guys better. Okay, sorry about that. There's been another question from Dr. Moulter. Given that the pediatric population is generally not severely affected by this particular virus and the very mixed evidence regarding pediatric role in the spread of the disease, at what point do the consequences and negative impacts of social distancing and economic shutdown outweigh the potential benefits in slowing the pandemic?
So while children may not be as directly impacted, they're getting kind of those secondary effects. And so they're very much so worried about their family, very much so worried about the adults in their life, but also honestly worried about themselves. They're hearing how terrible this can be. And while some children and adolescents in our pediatric population can rationalize that, okay, this is of, you know, it's not very likely to impact me, some of them are still very much so focused on how it could and are very, very much so scared. And so just even seeing a lot of children know that they've been told to stay at home and so have been very focused on that. And now that restrictions are being lifted and they're being told they can leave, they're anxious about doing so. And so we do see a wide range of how children are responding to this. And the hard thing too is because there are so many unknowns, it's hard to have clear answers of how to respond and how to act and what's the best course of action, quite frankly.
I think your question is a big one and a global one, and I think one that like so many people are questioning and wondering about throughout the world, really. Like, where is the line sort of drawn as to what helpful things to prevent the spread is doing, you know, I mean, I just think that's a huge question. It's hard to answer, but I appreciate the question.
I think one of the other concerns is that if we were to say no masks or no social distancing needs for kids because of their low risk of transmission, the concern still would be, especially like in a school setting, is the adults that work with the kids. It'd be one thing if the kids were home all the time and you said, okay, no social distancing and no masks. That's often what we do in our own homes already. But once you put them in places with other adults, then what do those adults have? Or what are we putting those adults at risk for? And again, it's a great question. And I don't think we have great answers for it yet. Hopefully we will at some point, but I don't think we do yet. Thank you.
One of the other around that point, though, is the urgency of some people to have kids back at Little League and soccer, etc., doesn't deal with the fact that the parents are going to be on the sidelines in crowds. It's not just the kids by themselves. So childhood activities are rarely without parents gathering around and screaming and yelling.
Very true. It may also have to be a situation where we end up prioritizing, you know, the things that open back up, where the schools open back up, but maybe Little League or basketball doesn't, or they have to enforce really strict social distancing rules for those kinds of situations.
Yeah. Parents can drop kids off, but not stay at the game.
Right. Exactly.
And the coach will have Zoom on the sideline.
Right. Again, well, not the best answers, but it beats, at least gets the kids out of the house and enables them to have social interaction, which is huge.
The other question that I had, you know, you talked about the difference in stress levels or psychological impact between nurses and physicians. Mm-hmm. At least on the inpatient services, I think nurses probably spend a whole lot more face-to-face time with patients and their families than physicians who make rounds and then move on. Does that extra time spent with the patients themselves maybe have some difference in that level of difference in anxiety, et cetera?
That was exactly what was explained in the literature I looked at, was the ongoing face-to-face contact. Sometimes the lesser training, not always, but sometimes the lesser understanding maybe of an illness or, you know, disease and how it spreads. It also, you know, did give the caveat that we didn't know a lot about other, like, pre-morbid or pre-existing mental health issues. So it's tricky. And also, I think nurses may often be reassigned to units they don't typically work on, maybe not here in our area, but in other areas they had been sort of just, you know, sent to areas where they weren't as familiar. And I think that was contributing. It was hard because the data was obviously very preliminary, but also, you know, and done very quickly, but with a lot of different factors that were hard to sort of tease out. But I think your point's exactly right. It's probably ultimately the more FaceTime.
Like, there's some comments, one from Dr. Syed here. St. Matthew's Little League will only allow one adult to attend games and practices once the season starts up next month. No grandparents or other family members. That's good. It sounds like at least maybe that will be happening for the kids.
That's interesting. I didn't realize that youth sports were starting back up again.
I was also hearing from our governor yesterday, and most of you may have heard him too, on my way home from work, about possibly being flexible about high-touch sports, maybe being rerouted to another time of year rather than this fall, and the idea of flexibility around when to start a sport rather than just being kind of rigid about the timing of it. And that may not work for every sport, depending on whether it's indoor or outdoor, but he was just sort of encouraging flexibility around when we hold certain sports, that fall and winter may not be the best time. We don't know. It's hard to predict, but it's also a good point.
And that's one of the things that kind of underlies everything going forward, is that flexibility, because there is so much unknown. And so how do we start implementing things again? And the thing is to do it in a flexible way.
One of his points was, would it be better to start the sport and then have to stop it after one game if we have a surge, versus maybe just thinking more flexibly? And I mean, no one can predict what spring would bring next year. You know, we don't know. But anyway, it's thoughtful, I guess. Food for thought.
Anyone else have any other questions or comments?
Yeah, just a great presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for your attention today.
All right. Thank you guys all so much for joining us today. Have a great rest of the week.
Thank you.